Well, thank you. That's really an extremely generous introduction. Kishore is an old friend of mine. We've been sparring intellectually for decades now, but it's a really great pleasure to be here at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. I love public policy schools, and this is really one of the best ones in the world. I've been here actually to teach a course around a curriculum that I helped to develop aimed at public officials from developing countries, and I know a number of the students in that course are in this audience, but this is a perfect place to do this, and I really do appreciate the hospitality of the school and the backing of the donors that make it all possible, and I'm really appreciative of having this audience tonight to do this S.T. Lee lecture. Great honor. So let me begin my talk. The themes come out of the last book that I just published in the fall called Political Order and Political Decay. It's part of a two-volume series on the origin and the evolution and the decay of political institutions. I think the easiest way to start the subject is just to talk about the world in the year 2015. It's been a very problematic world. Now, Kishore has pointed out that in this immediate area, things are actually looking, you know, in a way fairly optimistic, but there are large parts of the world where things have fallen apart in many respects. In the Eurasian continent, the world is actually, in a certain way, more stable and better organized than in the Middle East. And those two worlds, I think, are part of the theme of what I'm going to tell you tonight. So at either end of Eurasia, you have two big powers, Russia and China, that are organized around centralized states. They can project power. They have ambitions. They're territorially, I think, in many respects, on the move. And that world is actually quite a familiar one. It's the world of the 19th and 20th centuries where international relations focused around great powers and their interactions. But there's another part of the world that is very, very different. This part of the world begins in North Africa, goes through sub-Saharan Africa, through the Arab Middle East, through Pakistan, really up until the borders of India. And that world has been characterized for some time by the absence of coherent states or by states that are extremely weak. And we've seen since the Arab Spring broke out in 2011, the almost complete state failure of four Arab countries, Iraq, Syria, Libya, and Yemen, which is an unprecedented situation. We've seen the growth of groups like the Islamic State in Syria and Iraq. It is my opinion, and we can talk about this in the discussion afterwards or in the question and answer period. I continue to feel, despite the daily beheadings and terrorist bombings and so forth, that ISIS is actually, in the end, not that powerful a political organization, and that the reason that it's allowed, that it's been able to expand is that everybody else around it is so weak, that this is a kind of group that ought to be controllable by organized states, but there are no organized states in that immediate neighborhood. If you think about Islamic radical groups elsewhere in sub-Saharan Africa, you have Boko Haram in northern Nigeria that is on a kind of rampage right now, doing tremendous damage. But the only reason I think that they can do this is that the Nigerian state is highly corrupt, very ineffective, very low capacity, and they've still, to this point, not managed to mount a or to do the things that a state is basically supposed to do, which is to protect its own population. And in many respects, American foreign policy has been very much shaped by state weakness in this region. The United States invaded two Middle Eastern countries, Afghanistan and Iraq, but immediately found that the task was not the traditional one of fighting another state. It was to actually build state authority so that those states could be coherent projectors of power and protect their own populations. And I would say that after some almost 13 and a half years since September 11th, the United States has learned that it's not very good at this, that it really doesn't know how to construct state authority. And I think the legacy that it's left in these two countries is a very problematic one. And the underlying solution of terrorism is in many ways worse now than it was on September 11th, 2001. And so this is a very big dilemma in the world. Where does state authority come from? I've labeled in my books this problem as the problem of getting to Denmark, where Denmark is not the actual country Denmark. It's kind of a symbolic place that is stable, prosperous, democratic, secure, with very low levels of corruption. And the international community more broadly has been trying to turn places like Haiti and Somalia and Afghanistan into some version of Denmark, and they've been completely unsuccessful at this. Now, I actually happen to have a visiting professorship at a Danish university for several years, and I would say most Danes actually themselves don't understand how they got to be Denmark, so perhaps it's not that big a surprise that Americans don't know how this happened, but I think it's revealing of the fact that we who live in reasonably stable, developed countries take our political institutions for granted. We assume that there will be a monopoly of force and that there will be basic citizen security, and we don't really know how it came about that this sort of thing happened in the first place. I think that Americans, in particular, have a certain blindness, greater blindness about this than people from other parts of the world, because in the American tradition, democracy and law have been such important political, aspects of American political identity, these constraints on state power, that we sometimes forget that before you constrain power, you have to create it in the first place. And that's the part that we're not terribly good at. So let me set the stage. I'm eventually going to get to China and the United States, but I need to set the stage by setting a conceptual framework for how to think about this question of political institutions. In my view, you have three baskets of institutions around which any modern political order in one way or another needs to revolve. And these institutions are, in some sense, in tension with one another, which is why modern politics is difficult. The first of these institutions is the state. The sociologist Max Weber defined the state as a legitimate monopoly of force over territory. I think this is a good definition because that is, in fact, the unique thing that states do. They concentrate and deploy power in order to protect their population from domestic and internal threats. They provide necessary public goods. They provide services, infrastructure, health, and the like. But the important thing about the state is actually the power part. States are about power. States are about the ability to generate and use power. The second basket of institutions is what's called the rule of law. Now, you can distinguish between rule by law and rule of law. So rule by law is simply commands of the executive. The king or the prime minister tells the citizens to do something and they do it. Rule of law has to apply to the executive itself, otherwise it's not the rule of law. So if the king, the president, the prime minister can make up the rules as they go along, then that is not the rule of law. So the rule of law is fundamentally a constraint on power. It limits what that powerful state can do and ensures that it operates according to a set of rules that are agreed to by the community. And finally, the third basket of institutions has to do with institutions of accountability. In the West, we associate these with a set of procedures, free and fair multi-party elections, but I think it's important to note, especially here in Asia, that the goal of the procedures is substantive accountability, meaning that the political system ought to respond to the interests of the whole community and not just to the private interests of the people running the government. So in that structure, in this tripartite structure, you have one institution, the state, that is trying to accumulate and use power, and two other institutions, the rule of law and democratic accountability, that are limitations on power, that are constraints on power. And this is why there is an inherent tension in a modern political system, because if you go from one extreme to the other, you're not going to have either a just or a sustainable kind of political system. So if you have a state that is extremely powerful, you can do certain things with that power, but without constraint, it becomes a dictatorship. On the other hand, if you don't have a state and you only have instruments of constraint, then at one extreme you have anarchy, you have Syria or Libya. But even if you do have a kind of minimal state, if all you have is constraint, your citizens aren't going to be very happy, because governments are actually supposed to do things. They're actually supposed to provide services and the like. Now, final important distinction is between what, again, Max Weber called a patrimonial state and a modern state. And I think this is actually the one definition that you really need to take home with you, because it's very important. A patrimonial state is a state where the rulers regard the state as a species of private property. So in the old days, when you had kings and queens, the king could give away a province to his daughter as a wedding present, including all the inhabitants that lived in that province, because he literally owned his realm. Now today, nobody dares to say, I own my country. So we have what political scientists label neo-patrimonialism, which is a society, a political order, in which there's the outward appearance of being a modern state with a bureaucracy and a, you know, prime ministership and or a presidency and so forth. But the reality is that that political system is being run for the private benefit of the people running the system. And the reason that they are in politics is to enrich themselves privately. That's neo-patrimonialism. And both traditional and neo-patrimonialism need to be distinguished from a modern state. A modern state makes a clear distinction between public and private, and it says that the state itself serves a public interest and it serves it impersonally. Your relationship to the state does not depend on whether you're the cousin of the prime minister. It depends on whether you are a citizen and you are supposed to be treated equally by that state. And the state is supposed to keep its interest, the public interest, separate from the private interest of the rulers. Now, I would say that if you look at the history of political development in the last couple of generations, it's actually much easier to develop democratic institutions of accountability than it is to develop a modern state, to make that transition from a traditional to a modern state. And I think you can see that in American actions in Afghanistan and Iraq. So the United States invaded these countries. It tried to establish new political institutions. It managed to hold elections in both countries, or at least election-like events that produced governments that had some degree of democratic legitimacy. But what it was really unable to do was to actually create modern states, that is to say, impersonal, uncorrupt, effective state institutions that could protect their populations, that could deliver services on an impersonal basis. That was the really big failure. I would say that actually the big division in the world right now is less between authoritarian and democratic states than between patrimonial or neo-patrimonial states on the one hand and modern states on the other. I'll give you several examples of that. So let's take the conflict in Ukraine. What is it that all of these young protesters in Kiev were upset about, and why did they want to associate themselves with the European Union rather than Russia? It really didn't have to do with democracy, because Viktor Yanukovych, the president that was forced out last winter, was democratically elected, and I think everybody in Ukraine admitted that. What they did not like was that he was presiding over a kleptocracy in which he and his family personally benefited to the tune. I mean, we don't know how much money he managed to get out of the country, but it was a very substantial amount. And it was a typical regime that was being run for the private benefit of the insiders. You may have seen the picture of this gigantic palace he built for himself outside of Kiev, which was just, you know, one manifestation of that. And so the choice was really not between authoritarianism and democracy. The choice, you know, what Europe symbolized to these Ukrainians was that we want to live in a country in which the government actually serves public purposes and not the private interest of a clique of insiders. And I would argue that that's really the source of the conflict between the West right now and Vladimir Putin in Russia, because he is similarly presiding over this kind of a insider-dominated, rent-seeking, corrupt empire, and that's the fundamental principle. It's not democracy. Vladimir Putin, if there's an election tomorrow, would probably get 70-80% of Russians to vote for him. So the real distinction is that distinction between a modern, effective state and a patrimonial one. Another example would be India. So in the late 1990s, Jean Drez, who's an economist and an activist, did a survey of some northern Indian states, some relatively poor states. He discovered that despite the fact that they were getting paid 50% of the school teachers in the publicly funded elementary schools didn't show up for work on a day-to-day basis. So this caused a tremendous outcry in the Indian press. India is a very healthy democracy. It's got a lot of information. There's opposition parties. People got very upset. There wasn't anybody in India who argued in principle that teachers ought to get paid and not show up for work. So there's attempted reform efforts, and after 10 years, they do another survey, and it turns out that exactly the same percentage, 50% of teachers, are not showing up at their jobs. This is bad for India. It increases inequality in a society that is already very unequal. It harms Indian competitiveness. There's nobody in India that thinks that this is a good idea, and yet reforming that public education system seems to be beyond the capacity of the public officials and the governance system in that very lively democracy. And I would say that that, you know, is one of the reasons that Narendra Modi was elected in the BJP Prime Minister of India, because Indians, I think, at this point were just exasperated that their government can't do anything. They want strong leadership, and they're hoping that he will give it to them. Final example is closer to Europe, which is Greece. So Greece was ruled for a brief period by a junta of colonels. They stepped down in 1974. Greece returned to being a democracy, and it's been a pretty successful democracy. So two parties, PASOK and New Democracy, have changed places numerous times. There's lots of political competition. The problem with Greece, however, was that these two parties competed on the basis of their ability to provide their supporters with jobs in the public sector. And because you can't fire civil servants in Greece, every time one party would replace the other after an election, it would expand the payroll of teachers or bank employees or other kinds of public officials to the point that they had something like 7 times the number of public servants per capita that Britain did. And one of the reasons that they got into big trouble during the euro crisis was they couldn't control the wage bill of their public sector. And even after all of the external pressure by the Troika, this is still a practice that the Greek political parties have been very, very reluctant to give up. And so all of this indicates that, you know, one of the themes, so I think that democracy in many respects has not been doing well in many parts of the world. Many of these democratic transitions have not worked well. And I would say that there is a kind of common cause to all of this, which is this failure, this inability to deliver on basic governance. And by the way, this is why schools like the Lee Kuan Yew School are very important, because this is really a central task. That, as I said, in many ways, democracy is much easier to implement as an institution than is high quality governance and the deliverance of these basic services that is really the core of why people want to live under governments. So that's the general framework that I try to develop in the book, the importance of administration of states, of modern states. Let me turn to the specific comparison between China and the United States, because in many respects, I think that these two countries are at the opposite ends of a certain spectrum. So if you remember, there's three institutions. There's the state, the rule of law, and accountability. And in my view, a well-governed country has to balance these. So China is at one end of the spectrum. China has got the oldest modern state tradition of any society in the world. I argued in the first volume of my book, in fact, that China, that Western scholars have failed to recognize the fact that the Chinese were the first to actually invent not just a state, they didn't invent the state, but they invented the modern state. That is to say, a state that was centralized, bureaucratic, based on merit and expertise, and that they did this at the time of the Qin unification in the 3rd century BC. And so they actually beat any European society to this by about 1800 years. The problem in China is that they never developed the institutions of constraint. They never developed a real rule of law, and of course they do not to this day have anything that looks like democracy, and so in their history, they're very good at doing things that states do, but their problem is dictatorship, that the state is too powerful. The United States, by contrast, is kind of at the opposite end of that spectrum. Not that it's chaotic, but the deepest American traditions have to do with suspicion of government power. The United States was born in a revolution against the British monarchy and parliament, and therefore the founding fathers created a very complex system of checks and balances by which power would be divided and internally balanced against itself. And in many respects, I think a lot of the problems in American politics right now is that check and balance system has become a little bit too effective, that the power, it's difficult to exercise power. So let me elaborate on that a little bit. So China invented the modern state. They did this for reasons that the sociologist Charles Tilly identified in his well-known book on war and state-making in early modern Europe. That is to say, in the spring and autumn period and the warring states period in ancient China, this period from roughly 700 to about 200 BC, 500-year period, China went from having about 1,200 states to, at the time of the Warring States, about 16, and then to 7, and finally to 1, where a single political entity unified the whole of what was then China, the Western state of Qin, beginning the Qin dynasty and the history of a unified modern Chinese empire. The reasons that China invented state modernity are very similar to what happened in early modern Europe, that war created enormous pressures for raising revenue, taxes. You needed a bureaucracy in order to raise those taxes. And because of this remorseless military competition, the principle of meritocracy became very important. If you hired your cousin as a general, you would lose the war, and you would get slaughtered, and your whole family, your whole lineage would get slaughtered. And so there's a very powerful incentive to reward expertise in government. And in a certain way, that's been the Chinese legacy ever since then. So subsequent Chinese history after the Qin unification, you know, the dynasty falls apart. After a few centuries, there's a period of extended confusion, but China's default position is to reunify as a centralized bureaucratic state. By the way, it's almost the mirror image of India, because just as China was, the default condition was to be a centralized bureaucratic state, India's default position was to be a disunified, you know, collection of small principalities, periodically unified for brief periods of time. And I think that, you know, that contrast still exists in the contrast between the governments of the two societies. Now, in my view, the current government that is presided over by the Communist Party of China, the Chinese Communist Party, has many similarities to dynastic China and many of the same problems of governance in that kind of a bureaucratic society. The big problem, if you try to run a very large, geographically and physically large society from centralized government, is a problem of information. You don't know what's going on in your own society, and this was a problem in ancient China. That's why they had to delegate a lot of authority. But because you didn't have any local feedback loops, the government constantly had to pile centralized institutions of control one on top of another. So you had a bureaucracy, which was the primary instrument of rule, but then you couldn't trust the bureaucrats, so you had to have a corps of eunuchs in the palace that watched over the bureaucrats, but then you couldn't trust the eunuchs, so you had to create a eunuch rectification office to make sure that the eunuchs were behaving themselves. And in many respects, I think this is the problem of the Chinese Communist Party, that they need to control a very large, complex society. Their main instrument is the Communist Party, but within the party, you can't trust the party members, and so you have to have an organization department, and then you have to have more and more instruments piled on top of each other to keep this whole hierarchy going. If I can just give you a very brief balance sheet of what I think are the advantages and disadvantages of Chinese government, I would say the following, that the positive things that China has done since 1978 are very clear. One is rule-based decision-making. China does not have rule of law, and in fact, one of the deepest traditions in China, the argument between the legalists and the Confucians was that the legalists said we have to have clear laws and rules, and the Confucians said no, no set of rules is ever going to be sufficient to define all outcomes, therefore you need to grant discretion to a wise ruler who can judge the context and make decisions that are more suited to the actual situation. And one of the deep differences between China and the West is that the Chinese have always come down on the side of discretion rather than strict rules, and this has been the case in China. Nonetheless, since 1978, there's been a spread of rule-based decision-making. It falls short of the rule of law. The Chinese Communist Party makes the Constitution. The Constitution does not limit the party. Nonetheless, they have accepted rules on their own behavior. So one of the most important things they've done is term limits and retirement ages. So there's a 10-year cycle after which we're now in the third of these since Deng Xiaoping, in which the leadership steps down. If Mubarak or Gaddafi or Ben Ali or any of these Arab dictators had stepped down after 10 years, I think they would be very fondly remembered right now. And the Chinese, you know, have come to a system not really of constitutionalism, but of rules that increasingly govern their behavior. Second important advantage is institutional autonomy. This is actually one of the things that you can do in a dictatorially run society. You can make big decisions, big complex decisions, and you can implement them very quickly. So you think about what Deng Xiaoping did after 1978 to shift from a command economy to a marketized economy. No democracy could have done this remotely as quickly as he was able to do because of this concentration of power at the top. And so it's power that can be used under the right circumstances for very good purposes. Disadvantages of the system, I think, are pretty clear. You don't have instruments of constraint, and you've got this big problem of information. And so simply knowing what's going on in the society, just as in dynastic China, is a really big problem. The Chinese Communist Party doesn't subject itself to elections, which is the normal feedback loop in a democracy to find out what's going on and what citizens are unhappy about. And so they have to resort to polling and to, you know, they follow the internet, you know, partly to see what people are unhappy about, and they respond to demonstrations and outbreaks of violence, of which, you know, there are several thousand in China every single year, because that's really the way that people can express their unhappiness. But it's a very imperfect system because you don't have downward political accountability. And then the final two problems, I think, are probably more severe. One is a problem of legitimacy. So China still bases itself on Marxism-Leninism explicitly, but nobody really seems to believe in that. They would like to resurrect an older Chinese Confucian tradition, but that is really not compatible with Marxism-Leninism in any kind of open way, and therefore the default source of legitimacy is performance. But that's a weakness in the long run, because if the performance falters, then the legitimacy is going to falter. Then finally, the bad emperor problem. Problem with unconstrained political power is that periodically you get bad emperors. If you have a good emperor, I would say Singapore had a great emperor for a while. you can do wonders. You can be much more efficient and quick and effective than a democratic society with all the checks and balances and coalitions and interest groups. But the problem is, every now and then you get a really bad emperor. And I would say that if I were a Chinese person, the thing I would worry about right now under the current leadership is that the current leader has accumulated more personal power than virtually any other leader since Deng Xiaoping, and maybe, you know, he'll go on to get even more of that. And you don't really know whether he's going to be a good emperor or a bad emperor. It could go either way. I think it's too early to pass judgment on that, but it could go either way. Let me conclude by saying something about the United States, because as I said, we're at the other end of the spectrum. Our problem is the following. It's the intersection of two developments. So the one development is in American society. American society is extremely polarized. For most of the 20th century, the two political parties, Republicans and the Democrats, overlapped very substantially. But since the late 1980s, they have split apart, and there's no overlap whatsoever. So that the most liberal Republican is more conservative than the most conservative Democrat. That's one thing. Another is the rise of extremely well-organized and very well-resourced interest groups, which the American Supreme Court, in its great wisdom, has said is simply an aspect of free speech and therefore protected by the Constitution. Now, that's one set of developments which, in a parliamentary system, wouldn't necessarily be a bad thing, but our institutional setup is one of these very complex checks and balances in which power is split between a large number of different bodies within the government. And when you combine the polarization and the interest groups with this check and balance system, you get something that I label a vetocracy, meaning that it is extremely easy for minority groups, well-organized minorities, to veto things that are in the general public interest but against their short-term interest. I mean, we can discuss this further in the Q&A, but I think the most obvious example of this is our failure to adequately regulate our banks, because the banks are really rich and they're very powerful, and in a certain sense they've, I think, shown that they're more powerful than the U.S. government over the last few years. But there are other manifestations of this. I mean, the failure of Congress to pass a budget really since 2008, a tax code that is full of privileges rather than clear-cut liberties, and a general inability of the, you know, the Congress to deal seriously with the problems of governance that faces the United States. Now, I will conclude by just making some observations. I do not think that there is, first of all, I don't think that America as a whole is in decline. America is the only developed country that's growing. I mean, it's growing pretty well, and there's still a lot of entrepreneurship and innovation in energy, in, you know, where I live in Silicon Valley, in high technology, in a number of areas. The problem is really in American government. That's where I think we've really got decay and some problems. I also don't think that there's a general problem with democracy, because there are actually quite a number of democracies around the world that have done pretty well in the last few years. Germany, Scandinavia, the Netherlands, they've all made very difficult decisions. They balanced budgets and gotten more labor flexibility and so forth, and managed to achieve consensus. I think the problem that I'm describing is actually quite specific to the United States and a few other countries, maybe Japan, maybe Italy, and some others. So there's no general crisis, but it is important, because what happens in the United States, I think, matters around the world, because the United States is seen as a model to other countries. So I'm not going to conclude by making any predictions whatsoever about which of these systems is going to end up on top. I've learned after many long years to stay away from that. sort of thing. But I do think that this is a way of thinking about the world, that institutions do decay. They get renewed, so it's not a necessarily downhill slide. And, you know, Chinese institutions are also sticky, and so we don't know what the future is going to hold for them. But that's a way to think about, you know, the political dilemmas, I think, that we see in our contemporary world. So thank you very much for your attention. I look forward to your questions.